happening.
Oh, great. Now we're going to be arguing the entire time.
Yeah, well, you're just going to have to focus. I am, and I don't care who knows it. The way I see it, me being terrible isn't so much my problem as it is yours.
Why is it my problem?
Think about it.
Well...
if there's an issue, and I'm the one dragging you down, you're holding me up, so... Really, you're the one in trouble.
Okay. Well, anyway, people, welcome to our second PAX Prime prep stream.
Round two of four and karate chop motion.
Yeah, see, you realize that Robert isn't really good at improvising, so...
No, I'm not. Better than some, worse than most.
Exactly. Let me see here. Okay.
So, and Eric's not good at navigating mouse.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't want to have your... garish keyboard in my hand.
Okay, right. So we're gonna do our best to kind of run the stream and have some info for you guys. We've got a bit of a script this time around. So
yeah, scripts. We're still winging it.
Yeah. Nah. Well, you know, sometimes you gotta wing it. Sometimes the best things happen when things go horribly wrong.
This is like four player BF crap. Well, I guess it's co-op.
Well, I don't know. Why don't you just calm down and play the game and not worry about it? Look, I didn't ask you to come here and make problems for everyone. I didn't ask for excuses. I wanted you to come and enjoy this game with me and talk about PAX.
You already know what game you're playing right now.
We're playing Mercenary Kings.
Yeah, it took you a while to figure that one out, though.
A week for me to get the name of a game right.
Okay, let's get started.
All right.
Welcome, everybody.
I'm working on it, dude. Give me just a second.
So, if you watch the stream, welcome. Hope your day is going great. Tell me about your day.
Was it good? Was it bad?
Was it decent?
You don't have to tell me about your day. That's okay. I'm sure it was glorious, and you can just keep talking about that. Eric, why don't you tell everybody what we're doing here?
So, we're talking about our what to bring at PAX. And then we're going to discuss Pinny Arcade. Not the comic, but the pins that will literally erode your soul away.
So now that glorious summary has been given, I actually kind of just meant in general. For those who haven't actually tuned into part one of this stream, which happened last week over on our site at coinoptheory.com.
Basically, this is part two of a part four series of, hey, you're going to go to PAX, it's your first time, or hey, maybe it's your fifth, sixth time. Do you want to learn some new tips about how to manage your time well, what to bring? Oh, it's my first time being at an actual convention. Like, what should I do? What should I expect? Here's all the information for you to peruse. So you can have an amazing PAX. So first on the schedule is what to bring. What gear to bring. So, first gear that I like to bring is a nice backpack. I'm really against messenger bags. The first gear of the PAX had a really cool bag that went around my shoulder, looked really cool, put some pins and patches on there, and it looked really cool. The problem, though, is that after about an hour, hour and a half of carrying stuff around, your shoulder will start to kill you, and you will not want to be around anybody anymore. So a good backpack is adamant to have.
So before we go too far into that, to kind of talk about, we have a few things to kind of jump into here. First of all, for anyone who's not aware, we are playing Mercenary Kings. We've played this before. I've had a blast with it. This one is another one of those games that has been, you know, well received at PAX, and I think PAX was one of those times that it was it got a lot of its attention from things like PAX. So roll. Damn it, there we go. So super fun game. We're gonna play that while we're talking today. We're working on trying to get a list of some of the indies that have made a big splash at conventions like PAX, and specifically ones that we've played at PAX before. So this one's a little bit of a break from that, but still really fun, and you should definitely check it out. What else do we know? So, kind of a side note before we get hardcore into the gear, because I know like we have a lot of opinions about gear. So just to kind of preface a lot of that, gear is always kind of been important. I mean, you may have seen, if anyone's been following the PAX subreddit, there's actually somebody actually finally kind of beat us to it. Even though I don't care, I've been harping about it for years, so I can't. There was actually a journalist a while back who posted, or at least an industry professional that posted like kind of his his picture of his bag that he takes to a bunch of cons, not just PAX, which I really like the idea, and I really need to do it, so keep an eye on our Twitter. I may actually just kind of put together one of those everyday carry kind of pictures for my PAX bag. But yeah, it kind of grew out of this constant, like our first year we didn't really think about that kind of stuff. It's just like, oh, it's not a big deal. But one of the things to remember when you're dealing with your gear specifically is that you're not just carrying out what you carry in with you. There's going to be a ton of other stuff, and trust me, like, they give you the great, you know, people give you bags, and you sometimes you get bags that are almost as tall as you are. Remember those ones that they kept giving us that were just like,
oh, God, those giant,
yeah, just like,
what you can use
literally
for
like 4 feet tall, this,
yeah,
bag
you could,
was.
You could buy a baby somewhere and put,
yeah,
it in,
like,
there,
you
no
could,
one would know.
You could fit like an entire side of lamb into it. It was kind of absurd. I don't know why you'd buy lamb at a convention, but you never know. Just be prepared. But yeah, so you know, they give you'll get bags, but those things tend to be a pain to carry around. So when you're talking about backpacks specifically, and I think Eric's going to give some good examples of some of the ones he's run into in the past, but it's always important to remember that it's not just a bag to carry the stuff you're bringing in with you, it's a bag to carry the crap out, especially if your hotel is way too far away to walk.
Yes, which by the way is a like, I understand that, you know, money might be tight for you, but if you can afford it, a hotel close by the convention is a must.
If you can afford it, and nowadays if you can get it in time, that's one of the big things. If you weren't fortunate enough to get tickets and stuff for PAX this year, and you're thinking about going next year, PAX will always set up hotels in pretty much in tandem with ticket sales. If you want one of the nicer hotels, if you're prepping for that, get on it early and grab it. We tend to stay at one of the ones really close every year, because we're spoiled. But it's actually getting like competitive to get those hotels, almost as bad as actual PAX tickets. So yeah, keep that in mind. So yeah, that being said, sorry, just give you a little bit of preface. I mean, why don't you go ahead and talk about some of the stuff that you tend to bring, some stuff you found over the few years that works out for you.
All right. So other than a good backpack with good hoarding capabilities, I like bringing a good water bottle. And here's where Robert and I have a little bit of contention. I like bringing an actual bottle with me. I actually got one the other day from Target. Actually, let's pull it up for you real fast. In fact,
why don't you start the mission real quick and I'll pull it up for you. So we're fighting over the computer now.
Yeah,
that's
exactly
happening. Just a little behind the scenes action. I'm sure it's riveting. Yeah, okay. We may not end up playing multiplayer for this entire time.
I might just have him play because I can't do this. And you
that's
can watch
cool.
him play all
back
about
and
this game.
So we've got some links for you guys that, in the chat, so keep an eye on that, and Eric's going to drop those
ready
in.
Ready to roll!
Kind of do some of that stuff here.
Can I pop out of this, or?
I don't know. I'm sure there's some way to do it.
Yeah, you just play them.
Just like, yeah, it's fine. I'll just run. So we'll go split screen for a little bit while everyone watch Eric's super interesting split screen. By the way, I am absolutely the worst person to be playing this game, so that should be fun. Enjoy watching me be terrible.
It's like, if you ever, when you're a kid, you play Contra or like Metal Slug, you know, get like a good grasp on it. Yeah, he never did that.
No, yeah, I didn't. Just playing like, I don't know, Mortal Kombat and mixed up fairy tales. You know, the cheap King's Quest ripoff. I don't know why that game popped into my head just now, but it was fun. So, let's see here. So while you're looking up water bottles, what exactly is your argument for the full size bulky bottle?
Here we go already.
I'm legitimately asking.
I don't like having a little bag thing. So say one day it'll get punctured, I'm gonna lose it really easily. And I don't know, I like having the bottle. I think it was cool. You know, just like, there, I got a bottle right here in my hand, but I don't know. One of those weird things that don't make any sense to me at all.
Well, that's fine.
It. But I can't find a picture of it, unfortunately. But I got it for like $10 at Target the other day. A really nice like Star Wars water bottle.
Star Wars name dropping over here.
I know, right? Han Solo, yo. so that's
you
what
gotta
I
eat rations.
Have.
I'm in a trap.
When it comes, I think last stream I brought it up. But make sure that you bring a lot of like. Bring a bottle of water to drink water. You can't not drink water.
Yeah. Water's super important. That's why, and by the way, the reason that he's, and I'll go into it a little bit more in a bit, we're going to kind of take turns on gear, but the reason that he's talking about, like, a water bottle, or, like, a specific water bottle, like it's some kind of thing, is because I have this thing now that I try to minimize space, and one of the ways that I figured out to do it was by bringing collapsible water bottles. So we've kind of, like, we disagree, not necessarily, like, it's not exactly, like, keeping us up at night, but we have, like, disagreed on the purpose and efficiency of our water bottles, and whether or not it's necessary to have efficiency of space when dealing with a water bottle. I am straight up out of ammo.
Already. I'm out of ammo.
I don't know. I just am. Oh, there it goes.
He's not. Look, he's even infinite.
Dude, that guy just is not dying. Anyway.
What's next on my list?
Yeah. Stupid sniper. Got a piece of glass. I hate those little things.
A little thing. A little weird little.
The little, like, pygmy plant fuckers. Head grenades.
Alright. So, also like to bring is granola. So, I like having food. If you ever meet me, I'm always hungry. Just one of my things. You can ask Robert. I'm like, this is cool. Like,
so yeah, I've gone on more like wild goose candy runs with this man than any part of my childhood.
They have Egyptian curse on me, actually. I was like, you would always be hungry.
That's actually a pretty sweet Egyptian curse. I could think of worse ones. Like, you know, being undead or having like your eyes turn into turds or some shit. They got some fucking
weird curses. I've never read that story, by the way.
Look, I mean, you dig deep enough.
Anyway, so I like bringing like granola with me. So this year I'm gonna buy some bags for that, like, bare naked granola, cause it's kind of cheap.
Naked.
And it's like a resealable bag. So in the morning I can get up, get my food in, bring some fruit with me too, eat that either in line or in my hotel room, and just get going. Like it's not like a big meal, but at the same time it's not like crap. It's not like McDonald's or fry bullshit. Like it's good food for what it is, and it'll get you going in the morning. If you're a coffee person, I'm not really a coffee guy. Robert is.
Yes.
You can bring coffee with you or go to Starbucks. There's like 20,000 around the area.
Does get
You'll
expensive.
Find one. Yeah. It'll add up. So if you're on a budget, I would say skip it or buy like those little like cold coffee deals.
Yeah. Right. And that's definitely a side note to like to packing gear and like planning the stuff that you pack. Yeah, breakfast foods and stuff, like, even if you don't, like, so we kind of have an advantage now because we live in town, but, I mean, there was a year that we actually planned so far as, and this might seem a little nuts, but, like, we basically, like, made our, it actually ended up cheaper than, like, buying granola or trail mixes and stuff. We made our own, and it saved us a ton of money, and it saved us a ton of, like, effort, too, because we just had that stuff with us. So one of the things about being, especially at PAX, is, like, it is just freaking, it is hard as hell sometimes to, like, stop and get lunch. Ugh. Especially, like, if you're in the convention center and everything is like, oh, it's $1 million for a sandwich, that's cool. I'll just open a new line of credit to get lunch. So, yeah, that's definitely something to think into, like, take into account when you're trying to plan, you know, your space, is to, you know, plan for food. Especially, like, simple food. Like, I bought a bag, I got, if you're, you know, into, like, granola bars or protein bars, I bought a package of those Clif bars one year.
Oh yeah,
like,
I remember that.
Fucking Lembas bread, man. They'll you can go on like a day and a half. Make sure you drink water because you'll die, but like damn near. But yeah, they'll just, you can go forever on one of those things.
Yeah. I was about to bring aspirin with me. Tylenol, whatever. Like, you can go and get a little, like, individual packages of it, like, 2 or 3 with me.
Of what?
Of aspirin.
Oh, aspirin.
Because you never know when, like, oh man, like, I'm tired, I have a headache, or...
when your friend will have a headache for 2 hours, it miraculously disappears.
Exactly. Well, something like that happens to you.
We've told the story before, so we won't bore you again.
Exactly.
But, yeah.
But, like, or, like, some close in line, like, oh, man, I got a headache. Here you go, dude. I got you some aspirin. Thanks. Like, just like that, you know?
That being said, please don't take medicine or candy from strangers. usually not a good plan.
If it's a sealed package of ads, I think
I don't care. Okay. Just, right, well, it was just as true in third grade as it is today.
Of Robert and his mother, part one. Okay, thanks.
Pretty much.
They're trying to put razor blades inside your ad.
Yeah, my mother did legitimately. Like, my mother believed that whole candy thing to the point where she refused to accept that it was an urban myth, despite evidence.
Yeah. Yeah. My parents still believe that. Right? Like, don't, you have to, like...
It's nonsense.
I still remember my mother, like, having me spill out my candy on the table, and then her, like, with her hands, like, lightly tapping each one. Like, I was like, well, Mom, there's a blade in there. It's gonna stab you. Why don't you stop that?
Right. Give me your controller. I'm gonna kick you out of the game.
Okay.
Yeah, my problem is I can't even see.
Yeah, because...
Yeah, oh, there beautiful. We go, and that's much better.
Yeah,
now I can.
Yeah, now I can see the hell's going on.
Now
the game.
My head is in super HD. Yeah, no, look right? at that head.
Look at that guy's arm.
Look
man.
At that Rambo head. It's like a slab of bacon.
Okay.
Continue.
Okay. Next up, and we discussed this last time, but a very repeating alcohol gel, and they're cheap. You can buy a small one for like a buck.
You mean hand sanitizer, like normal yeah. people call it? Who calls it alcohol gel, Eric?
I do.
What is this, like, world according to CVS? Like,
okay, alright, hold on. Yes or no, Robert? Is it alcohol?
It is. Like, I'm not saying...
No,
look,
no, some
you
questions.
Are technically correct. Yes. I'm just saying you're pronouncing it like a crazy person. No one says alcohol gel.
Okay, if you call,
except
if you,
for, like, for legal reasons.
If you legitimately call it alcohol gel, give me a hell yeah in the chat log.
Okay, well, enjoy the sound of crickets and shame. I don't know what to tell you.
Nobody cares.
It says hand sanitizer on the damn bottle, for God's
yeah,
sake.
That's such a, like, what a whack way to say, hey, let's get some hand sanitizer. Like,
it sanitizes
gel, boy.
Your hands.
What's up with this? Give me that gel. Give me that gel.
I don't approve of your, like, random nonsense ghetto garbage.
See, look. How do you care about this game?
Yeah, I'm bad at this. I'm
okay. Also, with that being said, if you bring some hand sanitizer with you, you can, like, keep your hands clean. I would highly recommend that, let's say you go to a booth and say, hey, you'll play this game? And you're like, hell yeah, I'll play that game. And you play the game. Immediately afterwards, do not touch your eyes or your face in any manner. And then use a hand sanitizer, and then do your thing afterwards.
And if you're anywhere near an Oculus Rift at PAX, rub that hand sanitizer all up in your eyes. Because
yeah.
there is poop on that.
Yeah, and it will,
and it will give you and everyone in the vicinity pink eye.
Yeah.
True story, did happen.
Yeah, thank Christ we didn't go on that.
Not to us.
Yeah, thank Christ. You should have known, too. Like, this kind of thing would click.
As soon as I heard about it, I was like, yeah, that actually makes a ton of sense.
Batman with Talia al Ghul. Like, it's just not coming miles away, but no, we're just sitting there like, dope. Like, dope.
Yeah, you were still sore about that.
Yeah, I was mad at myself. Anyway, so yeah, like, you buy them really cheap, like, a buck, a little bottle, buy four or five, you know, spend $5-$6 on it, bring one for each day. That way, if you run out, you just chunk it, and get a new one the next day.
And that being said, like, it is important for anyone who doesn't know, which it was a big deal, so I'm sure a lot of people do. The reason hand sanitizer is such a big deal, like, there was literally a swine flu outbreak a couple years ago at PAX. It is not a joke. I think it nearly killed Mike Krahulik.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Please wash your damn hands. I did it.
So, yeah. Please bring it with you. If it's small, to keep in your backpack, it's not going to weigh you down a lot. Also,
really, hand sanitizer is one of the things where you don't have any excuses more, because they make it, like, in half-ounce things, and it literally will clip to any surface that has a loop in it.
Yeah, like,
so,
your dumb face
50
will
cents,
be fine.
Yeah, for just get it done.
Also, an extra battery. So, here's something that I got recently. I have not tested it out at PAX, but a lot of folks swear by it, and I'm going to swear by it myself. Is an extra lithium-ion battery for your devices, your tablet, your phone, or whatever. So, it's a Mophie box. I'm sure you folks know about it, right? But I'll go ahead and look one up for you to kind of...
You mean, like, the little, like, brick chargers that, like, USB plug-in? Okay, I gotcha.
Yeah.
It's, again, your weird names. I'm just like, well, I think most
people
call that a charger.
Sorry, folks. It just... I make things up sometimes.
It's like... It's like you grew up in an off-brand household and you just didn't know what to call
it.
We all did. You were never allowed to use the real words for things.
Well, that and also English was not my first language, so kind of like, yeah, you call it this. This is what things we call it nowadays. Like, okay. So right here, I'll provide you with the link, guys. So right there is like an example of a Mophie. It's $100. Yeah, I know. You probably find it cheaper like on Newegg or Best Buy or something like that. The reason why I buy this or got it is because, you know, it's what happens at PAX is that cell signal is very poor there, and you end up eating a lot of your battery up. Try and text your friends, try and tweet something out, check your email, whatever. And your phone constantly trying to find signal will just eat up your battery. So what this does is you plug it in, you charge it up, and it gives you like, you know, up to 1-2.5 times of the battery charge for you. So, you know, you just pick it up, you know, you throw it in your bag and you're charging it up. Middle of the day, you know, it's dying on you. You just plug it in, boom, there you go. That easy. Not bad, huh?
Not bad.
Okay, what's next?
I don't have enough stuff to upgrade my weapon, Eric.
I know, because
guys, just rude.
that being said, I'm also gonna bring one of these, but I don't. I used it last time, and it wasn't terribly good. Like the USB ports on this little charger I'm gonna show you are not the best. But if you're in the middle of the day and you just sit down in a hallway and you can plug into a wall for your phone, like your DS, it's a great, like, small, handy little power strip. So,
what you doing over there?
I'm looking up stuff. This is from Tiger Direct, but, like, go to Amazon, because Tiger Direct kind
of... Oh, yeah, that thing was pretty sweet. This was a pretty cool call by him. You, like, stumbled upon these things. And, I mean, these are things that, like, it's not like you've never seen these before, I'm sure, but they... A lot of people may not necessarily think about bringing this kind of stuff to conventions. And, yeah, it, if you have the space for it, especially, it'll save your butt. And a lot of this, too, comes from, like, my experience having to, like, cover these conventions where my devices were literally like my entire life for the day. So like, you know, when it comes to having everything, like keeping everything charged, it's a big deal. And yeah, I mean, you're gonna be using that stuff a lot. Like if you're at all interested in taking pictures, especially if you're like, you know, if you happen to be recording stuff on the floor, like your phone will die, and there is a massive premium on space around outlets. So it's kind of like the airport. It's just like, well, good luck.
Yeah, and like I have that's a great little charger because it fits like basically the palm of your hand, a little bit bigger actually. But you know, it gives you, you know, three little ports and two USBs. The best, but if you need to use them, you can use them. And that little plug, if you quit, so it goes in four different directions. So you're having issues with like people plugging their thing in, you just modify it and plug around them. And hey, honestly, you'll be a goddamn hero if you bring it with you. You will be like hanging out before a panel next to a wall. Like, oh man, my phone's dying. You plug that sucker in, you are like everyone's like all-star that day.
Yeah.
Like, hey dude, plug your stuff in. Cool!
Yeah, like I said, it's definitely a premium. And there's something to be said, and this is kind of a theme, and the reason we talk about gear so much is that there is kind of a theme running through a lot of the gear that we pick. Like, there is something to be said for good design with a lot of this stuff. Like, the fact that it's cleverly put together, and I'll definitely be bringing up some things that showcase that as well. It's not so much that they're useful, it's that they're just... Like, that thing has a really clever design, and anything like that that conserves space... Honestly, my kind of mantra when dealing with cons especially, and I'll explain why, is to think like a backpacker. And it's actually saved me a lot of headache trying to get stuff in and out, especially if you're going in for like, if you're specifically looking for swag and stuff. Yeah,
like it's worth the money. It's like, you know, $12 to get it somewhere, pick it up. Okay, so next up are a good pair of headphones. You will be in line a lot of the time. And yeah, talking to people is great, but you know what, if you're like me, every once in a while, you don't want to be bugged. You just want to be like, put some music on, put a podcast on, or play your DS, and just kind of put the world out.
Yeah, you will not be able to hear. Like, if you have noise-canceling headphones, congratulations, you win. Because it's just constant hum, so...
Yeah, but even like a pair of like, you know, earbuds helps out. Even if it's a cheapo, like, soul candy, who cares? bring it with you. Yeah, you'll, you know, that way you can kind of take a little break for yourself to admit a little bit. Mayhem that is PAX.
This thing always gives me trouble. I don't know what it is about that thing that gives me trouble. Because it's because it comes down at just the right angle that you can't hit it from either up or
side. Move forward, like make it chase you, then hit it when it's gonna actually
hate it. Don't approve. See? It even got me again.
So these headphones are great to have. If you can't spend money on a nice pair, don't worry about it. Don't switch yourself thin on that. But get a good pair and take care of them while you're happy, you know?
That being said, another side note to that, if you are traveling with friends, or even if you're not, one of the best things you can have, and it's super simple to carry, is a headphone splitter.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you have anything that you want to share, like if you, you know, hang it, especially if you're in line with friends, and you either want to play a game or... Because people bring, like, you know, and I've seen people with crazy setups, like people bring in full laptops, setups, all kinds of crazy stuff. Turn your controller back on. So a good headphone is actually a really good investment for that kind of thing, because, just, you know, like I said, I mean, if you're there with someone, I've brought that thing out numerous times, and it's actually been a really big help, in that kind of situation.
Yeah. Alongside that, like you're watching an episode of Coin Op Theory on YouTube, who knows, right?
Yeah.
You're like, oh, just watch this, well, here we go.
Which, you know, whatever, we'll be there, so.
Exactly.
You can just talk to them.
Directly.
We'll just do it for you live, right there on the floor.
Yeah, exactly, and then we'll...
No, we won't, that's a lie.
I would. Robert would probably just, like, look at you, glare, and
just
fall
like,
asleep.
Yeah, well, that would kind of be, like, putting on the show. If I could glare at everyone right now, I would. I just, you know...
He is glaring.
Our technology hasn't gotten that far yet.
So just remotely glare people?
Yeah.
Flash glare.
Just know I'm glaring at you in spirit.
Alright, also we have, iBrain. I know Rob will back me up on this one. A Nintendo 3DS. Bring one with you.
Honestly, just bring your handheld device. You know, Vita has the same capacity. It's just, I don't know. Nobody owns Vita. Sorry, Vita owners.
A couple games of Vita are pretty good.
Actually,
said,
want one.
That being said, if you have a 3DS and you bring it with you and you street pass, your entire weekend is now completely booked. Because you will be able to see everybody there. You'll get thousands and thousands of like puzzle pieces. You'll beat the monster dude at the end of the adventure game. Whatever. You just win.
This guy got... the only reason I think he owns a 3DS is because I basically gave him a job at PAX with mine. I brought mine the year before, and I was so tired by the end of it of like running through the millions upon millions of street passes that I literally gave it to him, and that's all he did in line in the morning was just run my street passes for me.
And he was sitting there like astonished I wanted to do it. Like, you know, it's fun. You meet people, talk to them, you get to like get puzzle pieces and stuff. You're just crazy. You're a crazy person.
Whatever, man. The best part is getting like, I don't want to say celebrity street passes because that sounds really douchey, but like getting like street passes of people. You know, like, I remember being in the panel room, like, chilling out one day, and then, like, check my street pass, and was like, wait a minute, that's Greg Miller. Yeah, I got Greg Miller's street pass from outside in the hall. That was a good day.
Greg Miller.
I have small goals.
Yeah. Fine. Keep going. There we go. Keep going. Right.
Well, fucked it up anyway.
Yeah, I know.
It was only a matter of time.
Keep going. So, yeah. Also, alongside the 3DS... Bring some 3DS games. Like, here's mine.
You
could
bring a 3DS and no games?
No.
What kind of insane person?
Street pass.
I just got it
all.
Like, it's just,
all you have
this is my Street Pass 3DS. My games 3DS is back at the house.
Yeah, okay. Well, anyway, the two types of games I could bring. I could bring long line games, like Fire Emblem, where you know it's going to take you a long time to beat a level or play through it. And like, hey, you want it for an hour and a half? Who cares? I can play a Fire Emblem for an hour and a half. No big deal. Or if you know like you're gonna the line isn't gonna quite that long, or you're not in a big loop for a long game, some quick games like Mario or like Star Fox for quick little matches or whatnot, something like that.
On the 3DS side of things, you and like or really any handheld, you will find people to play with. It doesn't matter what game you really are into. I know, and especially what I've seen a lot here lately. I mean, there's going to always be, like, Pokemon players. By the way, and you know, we should actually try to spend some time at the handheld launch this year.
Okay.
If it doesn't get us massively sick, because it's just a pile of chairs that everyone lays in.
Yeah, and farts in.
Well, I guess.
You mean the fart?
Yeah. Oh, the fart-held lounge. Yeah,
the fart foyer.
It's classy, man.
I know.
But yeah, like, so that, what are you doing, robot? Come on. Yeah, so that, that part of it, there's always going to be people to play whatever they want to play. I know I'm probably going to try to find people to play Monster Hunter with this year, and there's always people playing Pokemon. Most of the bigger, like, decent multiplayer games, you are not going to be hard-pressed. And if you keep an eye on the forums in a lot of those places, you'll probably find those people before you even get there, so definitely keep it in mind. And if you're on the fence about bringing your handheld, which, I mean, what else is it for, you know? Yeah, schlep it along.
Exactly. Okay, so here's one of those obvious ones. Your phone. Bring your phone with you. You know what? Might call your mom. Might need to text your buddy, like, hey, where are you at? Or lunch? Question mark? Let me do that. So bring it with you. There's Eric's obvious tip of the day. Yay, Eric. But on the same note of the phone, what I could do is have my, like, home screen just ready to go. So, like, if I see someone cool, I'll take a picture with me, or a cool cosplayer, have cool, I can open up my phone, hit the camera button on the side of my phone, or go to my home screen and hit real fast, and boom, there I go. But also things like your guidebook. Get guidebook for PAX Prime.
Yes, and it's not out yet. Probably by the end of this week or next week, it will probably be out.
I think tomorrow.
We know they're announcing the schedule this week, which is the panel schedule. It's probably not going to include the maps. They tend to release the panel schedule first, and then they'll come out with the expo hall maps and everything. I'm not good at roguelikes, you guys.
Yeah. We love Bloodborne.
I guess that does count as a roguelike, but that's a little bit different beast. Yeah. You'll find out.
So here's the next one. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to buy it probably this week sometime. So when you're in line, like, for, you know, a good part of the day, and if you're like me, your booty gets tired afterwards. I mean, like, it does. And I see people bring, like, chairs and, like, little stools and whatnot, which I really like the idea of it. It seems so bulky to me that I don't want to buy one ever or bring it with me. I don't want to, like, lug it around with me.
Yeah.
So what I'm going to do is, I see it on Amazon, and I'll link it for you guys.
Let me see. Oh, Amazon links. Okay. What's the matter?
This, like, feed your face? Feet, right? Yeah, exactly. Let me look it up. But basically, it's an inflatable cushion. It's like 15, 20 bucks. And you just inflate it. Let me see. Inflatable cushion. Oh, boy. We're all ready to go. I'm hitting myself. There we go. Right there. I think it's like a few bucks. It's on Amazon, so hooray, Amazon. Go there.
Fucked it up.
What it does is, it's a inflatable cushion. You pick it up, you just blow it up. It's small enough to fit in your backpack, but it might fit your booty, though. Hey, it's $8 and 7 cents. I'm probably going to buy one tomorrow. At that price.
Well, this guy is... he is feisty.
So don't jump it down, dude.
Wow.
This can save the booty. I have not tried it out myself. This will be my first time trying it, but you know what though? This is half better than, like, sitting on the cold concrete, like, for 4 or 5 hours. So, get one. $8. What do you think, Rob?
Yeah, no, that's pretty good. Wow, I am.
You die again already?
Yeah, I was paying attention. I was listening to you. This is what happens when I listen to you.
Yeah,
you know what happens when you listen to Eric? People die.
Yeah, that's about right. So, we're making a stream about listening to us, but don't listen to us, because we die.
What?
So, the idea of the stream is to inform people about what to bring to PAX, which means you can listen to it. You just said, listen to Eric.
Well, look, you know, everyone dies eventually. You gotta die something for it.
All right, there you go. Thank you. Anyway. Okay.
God, that thing is just angry at me.
Start shooting at him.
I'm trying to roll under him.
Why?
I want to roll under
him. He's an asshole. If you eat all those bullets, just, you know, start firing at his ass.
I mean, I got that part, but I'm trying to strategize a little.
Yeah, it's true. What's Mega Man all the time?
Yeah, that's true. I'm not very good at that either, though. God, he's just so salty about it. This is just not... Look at this. This is just a clusterfuck now. That's not even my fault. See? Look, it's just not...
Nice. Okay. So there's something that Robert King needs more information about. I never did this, but I know a lot of folks like to. Is to get a poster too. So yes, a lot of posters at PAX, most of them for free or cheap, that you can get. Having a poster too that you can buy at an art store for pretty cheap, you can strap on to your back or to your backpack, will save your poster from being jacked up either during the con or on the way home. If you fly home, it's gonna get wrecked somehow. This will save it. So Rob, take it away.
And let me, really on top of that, I mean, yeah, you nailed it. Like, you can buy really nice, I mean, in poster tubes you can get, it didn't seem like a big deal. You can definitely get one of the ones from, the problem with like just buying like a package, that it's hard to carry around. But, and for those being like, what do I need a poster tube for? There will almost invariably be, if you, unless you just absolutely hate all posters everywhere, like don't put anything on your walls, there will most likely be a poster that you will run into that you want. It just happens. Like, I like posters, but I'll go and like, I don't need any more posters. There is a poster there that I was like, oh, I want that on my wall now.
Yeah, it's like, bloodborne being smacked in the face by demon dick.
What is your thing with Bloodborne today?
I don't know. You were in a shirt. There's Bloodborne on it.
Oh. Okay, I guess that makes sense. I am. I forgot I was wearing it. I don't know. See, this is how much, like, you focus too much on the weird things.
I know I do. Sorry, Daddy.
Anyway. slow down. So yeah, there were like, that's the kind of thing. It's like, where people don't think about it, and then it's just like, ah, crap, I really wish I had something. And I've just screwed up more posters that I really wanted to keep in good condition just because I didn't have something to put them in. So if you have the chance to get something, definitely do it. And if you have the chance to get one with a strap on it, definitely take the time and the money. You can get them on Amazon. They're not really that expensive.
No. Or like, put you into like art and craft store.
And it, like, trust me, like, it won't fit in your backpack in most cases unless you just have, you know, unless you just really plan for it. Whatever poster tube it is you have is probably going to be awkward in your backpack, so one that has its own strap. It's the only other thing that I really advocate having that is not attached to your backpack. Why do you even bother? What is it even for, then? Disapprove of these enemies.
Yeah, it's a great that's, yeah.
It's a really good thing, again, that like not a lot of people think about, so.
Also, it's a two-parter right here, so there's gonna be a lot of people there that you might want to meet, whether it's like a streamer you like us, or like Mike and Jerry from Pinny Arcade, or whomever, even like a celebrity that might pop up.
Speaking of which, I'm super excited about something. So, among others, Grant Kirkhope is going to be at PAX this year.
Really?
If you don't know who Grant Kirkhope is, and it's actually super relevant because Rare Replay just came out, Grant Kirkhope is a phenomenal composer. He's done composition for probably most of the games you played but a fair few games that you played as a kid, including like Banjo-Kazooie and a ton of others. You should go look them up. And I actually am excited for like probably the least exciting reason. Do you remember that game Kingdoms of Amalur: Reckoning?
Yeah.
That had like, it was Kurt Schilling, who was like a former pitcher for like the Orioles or something, and he would know more than I do. He like started a game company, and he got Todd McFarlane of Spawn fame and R.A. Salvatore, who used to be my favorite writer when I was a kid, to do this game. But he also got Grant Kirkhope to do the soundtrack. I have the soundtrack, probably one of like the last existing soundtracks from the collector's edition.
Nice.
And I'm totally getting him to sign that.
That's dope, dude.
I know, I'm super excited. It's just like, it's probably like, what is this? Like, this game bombed so hard. Actually, the game didn't bomb, the company did.
Yeah, but poor Kurt Schilling.
Like, I know. It was such a good game. They had so much promise. Anyway.
Well, a fun note about Kurt Schilling is that, like, he had all, like, the right, like, part about it. He just had a very, like, sports-like idea of, like, how things work. It's like, well, if there's enough money at this, it'll just work somehow.
Yeah.
And that doesn't work in games. He came like, well, he's got a lot of money, he'll be a great player. No, it doesn't work it that way.
Yeah, I feel like that's
kind of the sports way of thinking. But now, anyway, bring something you saw, like a book, or I need to get a copy of Name the Wind from Patrick to fine. Anyway.
I'm not sure if he's confirmed he's going to be there. I'm sure he will, but he hasn't quite confirmed that just yet.
So he'll be there.
Honestly, and that comes into, like, if you feel like someone that you follow might be there, like, for instance, interestingly enough, because she doesn't typically go, she typically goes to Dragon Con, Felicia Day is actually going to be in the area the day before PAX, so she might actually end up at the show. I'm not promising anything. Probably just, I don't follow her on Twitter or anything like that, so keep an eye on it. But it is, it's not an impossibility. And there are a lot of people who, a lot of people are going this year. Pretty interesting. And there are, yeah, like a lot of streamers. I know, like people like Greg Miller and the Kind of Funny crew who follow them and all.
Ray from here.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if he'll go, actually.
Yeah,
they were just,
he said he did on Twitter.
Oh, did he? Oh, yeah. Cool. So I mean, and obviously, like, Rooster Teeth is going to be there. They go every year.
Yeah, anyway, yeah, bring something to the sign, you know, and
just keep an eye on your favorite people, and if you think they might, if there's a chance they might, because it's not like Comic-Con where you know everyone's going to be there, like, you know, and people bring stuff to that all the time, but if you think someone that you follow might be there, it's worth the, you know, it's worth the extra time to kind of pack something away. And
personally, I could bring two types of Sharpies, just like free posters, my books and whatnot, a black one and a silver one, depending on, like, the background it is. Because you have, like, a really dark background.
Yes,
like, I'm like,
bring,
like,
don't just bring black Sharpies, because you will be disappointed if you
exactly.
do one thing signed.
If you bring a silver one, it'll show up a lot better on there, and there you go.
And a lot of people will have their own markers, but don't ever assume that. Exactly. It's usually handy to have something of your own there. Wow, that didn't work.
Okay. Also, if you're like me, and I'm sure a lot of folks who are watching this wear glasses. I wear glasses, so does Roberts. Do yourself a favor. Go down to your local sunglass hut. It's like $10 for steal. What it is a little, like, vial of, like, spray cleaner and a little, like, cloth to clean your glasses off. Why am I telling you to buy this crap? Well, it's not crap, by the way. It's, first off, you get a free lifetime refill on a little, like, spray stuff they give you. Two, a little cloth. They give you, like, a little microfiber cloth. You can wash in the washing machine whenever you want.
Interestingly enough, there was a company that actually gave those out at PAX South this year.
Nice.
Yeah, so if anyone's ever played like that, I think it was kind of short-lived. I'm not sure if it's around anymore. That it was a mobile MOBA. That's an upsetting phrase. called Vainglory. And for whatever reason, that was like their marketing trick
that
was that they
stuff.
Handed out like screen cleaners and
yeah.
like eyeglass kits
yeah.
that you could clean stuff with.
Because your phone's going to get gooey after a while. Your glass is going to bust it up.
Gooey is... an interesting word for it, but probably
well, yeah,
accurate.
You're like, yeah,
just
your,
like,
your
it's
fingers,
just got
sweat,
all
your,
over
your
it.
Alcohol gel will get
it's
on
like,
there.
Like I'm, Slimer's on the other end taking notes. It's just like, oh, my phone is going to get gooey, because
yeah.
I'm Slimer.
but it just keeps your stuff clean, you know, because I have a weird thing now where I hate when my glasses are dirty at all. It's a bunch of crap out of me. I feel like I can't see out of them, so I'm just like, meh, clean them off. Yeah, it's a cheap thing, $10, plus you get free refills. Not a bad deal, you know? Another thing you need to bring, lots of money. Bring cash with you.
That's so sad. I actually feel bad that you have to say that now, because I still remember our first year. We brought literally no money. Well, we brought all of our money and didn't spend any of it.
A goddamn dime. Bring money. Like, I'm the kind of person where I'm very conservative when I go to PAX. I don't go out and buy a lot of stuff. But, you know, bring some cash, because not everyone takes cards at their booth, especially the smaller ones.
That being said, most people will now. So if
yeah.
you're worried about that, I mean, Square and a lot of, like, you know, Blue has changed the game on that a lot.
True.
I think I used cash maybe one out of five transactions last year.
Yeah, but having cash is kind of nice, just for...
Planting into this guy. I know, dude. I don't know. I don't have the. It doesn't have the right shape for my brain.
A sidecar with you.
Yeah. Something in
a
sidecar. Oh, this
hey.
Bastard again.
Okay. Boom. So like, he's got a pattern. So
I'm aware that he has a pattern. I'm saying I don't like.
So, reload. Come
it's
on.
Just like he. That's the part about it. Is like he fires when he lands. So there's no like.
You,
I don't know what I'm
you
supposed to
jump.
Do.
Like land down
you
with him.
Jump.
Anyway, I leave. Fuck you, I'm out of here. Now bring money with you. Don't feel like you need to bring like $400 in cash. Don't do that, you know.
You sound like everyone's dad right now. Always have $20 in your wallet. Like,
don't tell anybody about it, because they sadly know about it, they're gonna have you for tomorrow. But you know, bring some money with you, of course, don't be an idiot, don't go flash around like a dumbass. Just keep in your pocket, keep in your wallet. Keep a wallet in a safe place, because there are safe pockets in Seattle, you know? Now, God, like, we're old men now. Like, watch out for pickpockets. Don't keep things in your bag.
See, I had that problem off a long time ago. I don't wear my wallet in my back pocket. I just have a super thin one that fits in the front, so it's actually good.
Okay, let's go on to Pinny Arcade. You ready?
Yeah. Well, actually, no, because I have a few.
Different types of.
So, packs. Yeah. Well, then there's lots of different things. I tend to have packing down to a bit of a science when it comes to these things. Speaking of which, if you are traveling into the city, one of the things to note, and I actually didn't write this down, but I just remembered it. Do not ignore the idea of having space in your, like, so, you know, assuming that you're flying in and you bring your backpack and a carry-on, or, you know, you check a bag even. Don't ignore that extra space in your bag and just fill it up, because you might actually find that a lot of the stuff that you want to keep will not fit in your backpack on the way home. I remember my first year, I filled my suitcase up. You know, I had clothes and everything. It's like I had enough room in my suitcase for the stuff I had. And yeah, it was awkward getting stuff home. Look up different ways to pack your clothes that save space, and give yourself maybe a half to two thirds of the room in your bag.
Yeah.
Because you will you'll save yourself some headache later on. I would definitely look up. I would specifically look up how to, like, roll your clothes. I roll my clothes in like sets now when I pack. It's something I found on Reddit. It's actually kind of a unique little way to do it with. You basically roll, I'm sure you can find it, but if you roll up your stuff and tuck your socks in on either end, you have these, like, little pods of clothing. And, yeah, it's actually super handy. But, you know, there's a couple things. Like, so, you know, we've been talking a lot about the things that you can put in your bag, and obviously it sounds like, you know, you bring all this stuff in my bag, it's just going to be full. It's definitely good. One of the things that I bought a long time ago that has served me really, really well, especially in PAX, is to kind of hold on to that stuff. Cocoon makes this thing. It's a company called Cocoon. They make this thing called a Gridded. And basically what it is it's a small, like, paper-sized grid of straps, and it'll hold anything from cords to, like, devices, headphones. I think right now on my Gridded I have four or five pens, like, really the only pens in my backpack. Four or five pens. I've got thumb drives that I use. My thing of business cards is in there. My headphones, my headphone splitters, things like that. That just doesn't. They're really space saving. They save you a ton of room in, like, the little pockets where it's like, you know, oh, this is, like, full of charge cables and, you know, USB drives and stuff. It's like, well, get that stuff out of those pockets and put it on one of those, and it actually saves you a lot of effort. Another thing that, going back into detail, one of the things I started doing a long time ago, and I actually have, if Eric will drop it in the link dump there, something that I found a while back, instead of taking up space in, like, my backpack, and it's actually because the backpack I was using at the time didn't really have a slot for a water bottle, like a full bulky bottle, and I didn't want to carry it around in my hand. I started buying collapsible water bottles, and there's actually a company that makes one, and they're really cheap, about $20. They make one that essentially rolls up in itself. It's got a little, you know, beaner, like, carabiner clip on it, and it just rolls up into itself, and it'll hold, what is it, like, you know, 17, 18 ounces of water. Enough water to get you through about a half a day.
Yeah.
And then when you're, like, and it clips onto whatever when it's full, and then when it's empty, you essentially just roll it up, and it takes up about the size of a pack of cigarettes, maybe.
Yeah.
And I clip it to the outside of my bag, and it's been with me through three PAXes now, the same water bottle. I think I'm actually just thinking about replacing it this year. And it has served me very, very well. So, again, like, you know, there's plenty of argument for, like, having a huge water bottle with you. But if you're looking for a way to kind of conserve space, it's definitely worth looking into, you know, why am I carrying this huge water bottle around? Maybe I should carry around something that, you know, collapses. Anything that collapses is usually a home run when it comes to this kind of stuff. So,
fair point.
And speaking of which, and another kind of thing, with this kind of came off of my, like, my theme of thinking like I was going backpacking. He was talking about buying something to sit on, or, you know, things that you're, when you're sitting in line for so long. I actually bought a camp pillow from, or you can get them from REI. They cost practically nothing, And I have one that rolls up into, again, it's about the size of, I don't know, how big would you say it was?
It's pretty small.
Maybe about the size of you know, of like a small water bottle. And, man, the thing is, it's super comfortable, it's super versatile. If you're flying, it works perfectly on the plane. You know, because people always have neck pillows and stuff, but the neck pillows don't always pack very well. Those can't pillows, collapsible pillows, blow up. Like, you know, I bought one, basically I have one that it actually blows up. You can blow air into it, but it has foam inserts and stuff. And yeah, it's fantastic. And it's again, these have become like staples of my gear when I go to any convention, but PAX especially. And yeah, it just helps a lot.
It'll stay with Annie. And back on the idea of water bottle for fast, like, you know, they have a bunch of water fountains around the con. There's tons of them everywhere, so don't feel worried about not getting water. That being said,
it is city water, it's convention center water, and it's kind of like,
whatever. Yeah. I'm just saying, but if you're worried about that, I know they sell, like, water bottles, like, filters in them.
They do, yeah. Well, I mean, there's life straws.
If you want to be like, yeah. I hate city water, I'm really worried about it. That's cool. Just buy one of those, and there you go. No big deal. Hey, how you doing? Welcome to the stream, by the way. We're discussing PAX prep stuff. I hope your day is going well. You missed a couple of links, but you know what, though? That's okay. We still love you.
We're going to try this time around, because we didn't have two terrible mini links. I am just going around in circles.
Anyway, we need
to try to put them in the actual dumps this time. Okay. So.
There you go. Speaking of water bottles and water in bathrooms, at PAX, the bathrooms will get, but they're at least a guy. I don't know about the ladies' restroom, but the guys' restrooms get really gross, really fast.
I haven't actually encountered that too badly.
I think the first year, like, horrified me, where, like, I went, like, midday, had to go to a bathroom really bad, went to a bathroom, and it was just, like, a foul den of, like, sin, and I was like, you know, this is not great. So, I'm the kind of person, like, bathrooms don't gross me out, but like if I have the option of being in my own bathroom, I'm down with it. So, kind of thing is planning your bathroom breaks out for your like your drop-off points. Speaking of which, having a designated drop-off like, period for your day is great. And what we mean by that is, you know, you get up, you go to your big panels or your big games, and then about 1-ish, you're probably gonna be hungry. So go with your buddies, drop all your excess swag off at your hotel room, and you know, get a little break in. Put your socks out if you want to, put some more deodorant on, take a shower like me, like I always do, and get some food. But you know, also take your bathroom break as well. This is a great little kind of midway point of your day to get refreshed for the day. For the next stretch,
it really does make a huge difference. A lot of times when you're when you know you get about midday and you think I've got a little bit of juice left in me, but like no, if your hotel's close enough to walk back, like if you've accumulated a lot of junk, it's much easier to go back and drop it off at the hotel than to like okay, let's sit down in the middle of the convention center and like figure out what to throw away, figure out what to keep.
Which paper mask I want to keep.
Yeah, exactly. Like which weird blow up sword I like better. Like you know, I mean, it's just much easier to go back and like, and it's you know, it's one of those things where like. Especially if you're with a group, it's a good reset point for when we're like, alright, let's meet back here at this time, and we'll head back to the hotel and drop things off, and you can take just take a minute to reset. That being said, don't take too much time, because then you get comfy in a hotel room. Hey, I did it!
Hey, good job, you didn't die!
Two tries. I tried.
Everyone,
I did once.
Congratulate Rob for not fucking it up! Yay!
Hey, is that gold, or is that, like, shitty bronze?
That's doo-doo cheese.
Just like, this is the cheese metal. It's
made
of...
For being okay
for being...
Okay, I think we discussed what to bring. Now, here comes, kids, the infamous Pinny Arcade.
Yes,
Let me set you up about what Pinny Arcade is. So, let me link you something first. So,
I feel like your setup is not really going to sell it very well. We'll see. Go ahead. Continue. Now that I've tempered expectations.
I'm so organized. My name's Robert.
To be fair, I didn't come by it, honestly.
Okay, so a couple years back, Mike Krugelik from Pinny Arcade was thinking about it'd be cool to have some kind of little thing people traded at PAX.
It was actually based on
the Disney ones.
The Disney ones, yeah. He went to Disneyland and came back and...
Yeah, there's Pinny Arcade right there, folks. Check it out. So, you know, there's pins that you can buy core sets or you can buy extra sets if you'd like. And the idea is that you can meet people, you can go to certain panels or certain booths and get official Pinny Arcade pins, which they'll have emblazoned on one of their little banners. And you can earn them and trade them and collect them and literally, you know, sell your soul to these pins to have them all. Robert and I are very different on this whole ordeal. I'm the kind of person, I don't want to spend very much money on this kind of stuff. And if I can just trade for it, I'm going to do that. So, personally, me, like, I've spent very few dollars on Pinny Arcade stuff, but I traded some stuff away. That's okay with me. But Robert, you're the kind of guy that wants to buy these things, so.
Well, okay, so what you say that, I feel like you, like, you may have had a bad representation of what I did, because actually when it first started out, so we first started out, I think this started the first year that I went to PAX with my fiance, and she fell into it like hook, line, and sinker, like got all the things, and she grabbed the corsets when they came out, and she talked me into grabbing the corsets. She was like, yeah, this sounds like fun. I'll spend a little bit here and kind of like trade out for these things and see where it goes. And what it got down to it, the biggest problem, and I will just warn, you know, I warn everybody about this right now because I have no problem saying this. It is absurdly expensive. It's actually to the point where it's like, you're not really paying for, like, you're talking about paying, you know, $30 for the core set. And they actually just announced a new core set. They retired the old one. You're paying $30 for a core set of four pins and a lanyard. And it's even to the point where, like, you know, you have to have, like, this official lanyard on to trade, you know, quote unquote. People don't really care about that rule. But, and most of the times if someone sells an individual, if a company, so companies have to kind of, like, apply for this, because there are official ones, and if it's not official, it doesn't count. And people have to apply for this, and the manufacturing process is fairly expensive. So pretty much one of the two ways you're going to get these things is either A, you know, some of the bigger companies will just eat, you know, they'll consider it a marketing cost, and they'll give it to you for playing the game. Others will just flat out sell them, and most of the time you're looking at anywhere from $10 to $15 a pin. I've never seen them for cheaper.
Like 15 is like a standard rate.
15 is pretty much the standard when you're dealing with the, you know, the third parties that tend to do this stuff.
Yeah, the rock person.
Yeah, and you know, they'll do cool stuff with it. Like I've bought a couple of pins that were specifically for charity, specifically Ross, you know, Patrick Ross's pins. He did it, but he specifically sold them for his charity, for his charity. And I've got no problem getting behind that. Oh yeah, that's right, I got it detonated, don't I? But there's that. But that being said, like, you know, it's, you really do have one of two options. And I kind of, at the very beginning, I was almost kind of insulted by how expensive it was. I was like, this is ridiculous. Like, you're paying, like, there was, you know, I had, and of course, like, there's this collect them all mentality. And to collect them all, you have to spend absurd money. Amounts of money. Like, yeah, you have to spend real money and your time. And a lot of them, they're, you know, super exclusive ones that, you know, I mean, there's one of them that's worth several hundred dollars because it just doesn't exist anywhere anymore. They did one as a perk for kickstarting their podcast. And that one is actually probably, like, it's the rarest one, and people just go nuts for it. A lot of that, it comes down to kind of deciding how much you want to get into it. But that being said, it's pretty fun. You know, it has this. There are several rules to it, and the pins are really high quality. They're really cool looking. If you're into Pinny Arcade, the comics and stuff, a lot of the characters, I have this rule now that I'll say is, like, you say I spend a bunch of money on, but I actually kind of have this rule now. The ones that I keep are the ones that are connected to something that I actually really am into, like an aspect of the Pinny Arcade comic that I appreciate, like the Deep Crow is a good example, or I have ones that, like, one of the Killer Instinct ones that was made is an arcade stick, and I fell in love with that one, so I grabbed that one up. If there's anything that it's not like, oh, I don't really have a special attachment to this, I won't buy it, or I will find a way to get it cheap and use it for trade fodder, which the rules of the thing are that basically if you go to any of the events or you find any of the actual people on staff, they have to trade with you. So anything that they have, you can trade them for, as long as they're like, hey, I'm trading pins. Even if that person, like, you know, if a person from the staff gets traded some super rare pin, and you have like some just nonsense garbage one that, you know, you got 20 of the day before by standing in line, you can trade them for that really rare pin, and it's just like, hey, cool, I didn't have to, you know, this thing's worth, you know, who knows how much to the right people, and I just got it for free, so.
Yeah, it's a fun little side note to PAX, you know?
But it is taking over PAX, so you will absolutely hear about it at some point. So it's important to know what's going on before, just so you're not like, what's this? And I don't understand. It's like if you see people running around with, and even now they have, like, flashy bags that they just announced. You see people running around with this stuff, like...
Man, it's like, this gleam in their eyes, and it's maniacal gleam, like, oh god, it was a person.
And be warned, of course, like, so the fact that it's gotten so popular has actually spawned, if you notice, a lot of vendors and a lot of game developers are making pins now to sell, like, on their own or to give away at their booths. I'm fairly certain. I never saw that at any convention. Yeah. I never saw people giving out pins in, like, really large quantities before Pinny Arcade took over. But that being said, most of those are unofficial. If it is an official Pinny Arcade pin, like if it has the seal on the back of it that is makes it part of the game, Pinny Arcade announces all of those. Every year, there's Pinny Arcade. There's a Pinny Arcade website, and it is P-I-N-N-Y, of course. So there's a specific website for it, and they will always announce those about a week or so before the show. So keep an eye on that if you're interested. And like I said, yeah, and the cool thing about it is, and Eric can attest to this, is that you don't necessarily have to go buy, like, the first set or something like that. Yeah. Eric has gotten a fair few handful of them just by trading, you know, like going and standing in line. And if you, you know, a lot of times the games that you get them for, the line moves pretty quickly, so maybe you can go in a couple of days and maybe grab yourself, you know, three or four duplicates of a pin, and then, why can't I get in there?
Oh, no.
Javelina asshole, Jesus. He is.
I know. Yeah, like, you do not have to spend a lot of money doing Pinny Arcade, but it is fun. And that being said, he was talking about, like, the non-official ones. Don't feel ashamed of getting them.
They're awesome.
There's
a
couple really
several.
Cool ones. Just don't think that they're going to be worth something one day, nor should Pinny Arcade be used as an investment device to begin with. They're not being babies. They're not worth millions of dollars nowadays.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, it is. It's not, you know... there are a ton of people who will do it for the value, especially ones who like collect the really rare ones, like the DLC podcast bin and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just have fun with it. Like, if you have money to spend on it, it's definitely a cool little version. Some of them are really cool. I've got some really cool stories. I've actually got good stories that go along with some of the pins that I've collected over the years. It's fun. But then again, it's not vital. It's not supposed like this is. Now part of the Pinny Arcade experience, you have to do it.
Yeah, it's pretty fun.
But it is a lot of fun. Yeah,
it's cool. It's a cool deal. And I think last year you went to some kind of Pinny Arcade like trade night kind of thing.
Yeah. So at every one of the every PAX there is a Pinny Arcade trading event, and essentially it's about 2 hours. And like I said, the rules of the game are anyone in the crowd you can trade with if you want to, and it's, you know, standard trade rules apply. Like, you just I want this one, okay, let's trade. But the trick to it is that people who are affiliated with PAX, so like any of the Pinny Arcade staff, Mike, Jerry, Robert, all of that, and even all of the enforcers, they will have designated times that they're like, hey, I'm trading pins right now. And there's actually a booth up in front of the, right by the merch booth, you know, in the front of the convention center, that people will sit at, and they will take kind of shifts. Doing this, and the rule to them is that if they are trading and you see a pin of theirs that they want and you want to trade for it, they have to trade with you. They can't say, oh no, well, I want this one instead, or I want this. And so the great thing about the events is that people are trading in bulk almost. So there's actually a lot of times like, oh, like I really want this pin, but I don't have it, or I don't really have. Nobody wanted to trade me what I had. You can go. There's a fair chance that if you hang out, you know, and watch the tables. One of the staff will have that pin, and you can run up and swap for them. So they make it a lot easier. It actually makes it a lot easier to get into the whole game. That's kind of what got me into the game on it. Like, before, I was just collecting them as I found them to be like, oh, this is one that I like. I'll keep this one. But when it got down to the point of the pin trading events, I kind of fell into the game itself, because it's also a really cool way to meet the staff and stuff without having to wait in some, like, ginormous line or fight a crowd or get lucky, you know? So if you're, you know, if you follow Pinny Arcade and you like what they like, the people that are actually there, then it's a good way to meet up with them and all that. Yeah. I'm honestly at this point, I don't even really know where I'm
going. I know, but you're just kind of digging around, aren't
yeah,
you?
Well, it's like, I don't, like, nobody's dropping coins, so I don't really know where I'm, like...
Okay, so, that being said, Pinny Arcade's awesome. If you want to do it, do it. If not, well, next, and our final topic tonight is something very near and dear to both of us.
Yeah.
Is the PAX Prime party. First off, there's a lot of parties at PAX Prime every single year. Some are announced, some are ultra secret, and they're hard to get to, but let's discuss the open ones first. So, in my opinion, there's two types of parties when it comes to Pinny Arcade, of the announced ones, for example. The ones you pay for, and the ones you get for free. Mm-hmm. So, and you can argue if you'd like to, but...
No, you're absolutely right. Yeah.
So, if you go right now to the Pinny Arcade forums for PAX Prime, there will be a thread about the party. And people are promoting it, which is cool, you know? And I'll provide a link here of also the side questing people, their list as well. So, you know, a lot of these people use Eventbrite to announce and also have tickets ready for their party. And some are completely free. Hey, Friday night from like 10 to 12, 10 to 1, there's this party at this place close by the convention, come one, come all, or 21 and up, or whatever it is. Sign up for it and go. If you see that, honestly, I sign up for any party that I expect that it's free. Even if I don't go, I grab a ticket for me, my buddies, or myself.
Yeah,
just because, you know what, it's an option for you.
Yep.
And a lot of times, these parties are pretty cool. They have free food sometimes, free drinks sometimes, at least a bar to go up to. And hey, sometimes we get like, cool, like, exclusive, like, demos on games that you didn't know was going to be there. All I ask is that you go to a party, hey, have a good time, don't be an ass, don't get kicked out. But you knew that already, didn't you? And on a side note, Robert met his now fiance at a party because of me. Yay, me! Matchmaker, yeah. Make me a match!
Just
catch me
writing yourself up there, aren't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I know, right? So I'm like a
no, dude. They are a ton of fun. We've had some really great ones. Again, some of them, like, even the free ones, for example, Bethesda tends to do something every year at PAX Prime. That one can
never be announced if it's there.
Yeah, it's usually kind of hard to guess. I mean, if you're following Bethesda stuff pretty closely, there's a pretty decent bet you'll run across at least mention of it. Yeah. So just keep an ear to the ground and you know, check it out. But a lot of them are really fun, and they're definitely something to do if you don't have something planned, if you're not planning to hit the tabletop stuff up, or you don't really have anything specific you want to do, you know, after the convention's over. It's really a good way to wrap up your night. A lot of them you will get like at least free drinks. Some of them will have some really impressive food spreads too. So
we went to the Guild Wars party a few years back, and that was good.
Yeah, I think like and again, obviously the size of the company that's putting on the event itself is gonna kind of dictate the level of quality of stuff that's gonna be there. But that's not necessarily always the case. Just, you know, don't expect to like, oh, I'm going to these like indie guys party and maybe they'll have like free food and drinks. It's like you might get a free drink out of it, but you know, but again, if you're going just for free stuff, then you know, keep that in mind.
And then that being said, it's like some small indie companies and party, they're probably not going to have anything free for you or anything at all for you.
Actually, you would be surprised.
Well, sometimes, yeah, but that being said, if you go to an indie party and they don't have like a spread for you, don't be offended. In fact, they're there because they want to promote their game and they probably work really, really hard on it.
Sure.
While you're there, you're having a good time, like tweet it out, Facebook it out, whatever, of how cool this is. It's for the word about their game because you know what? They work really, really hard on that game and they deserve a little shout out every once in a while.
And then again, so, if it's awful, you don't necessarily have to
do exactly.
That. Because sometimes people put that stuff together. I know I went to one of them last year and I won't name names, but like, yeah, where it's obviously they had spent a ton of money on their, like, you know, presentation, their spread, but it really just was, I mean, there was nothing really there that was worth, like, they weren't really all that enthusiastic about them, or there wasn't really anything there that really stood out. It was a lot of stuff that seemed like it was the same thing over and over. So, yeah. You know, but I mean, like, always do your research and always kind of like keep, but it's always good to keep a few on hand, just kind of like, hey, if nothing else, let's go over here and check this out.
Yeah.
You can always bail on a party, you know.
Yeah. When it comes, I was going to say earlier, just talk to the party. The free ones, the ones you got paid for. I've never, ever gone to a paid one before. Personally, I'm against it. That's just me, though.
Yeah, a lot of times those are the ones that, like, either... It's really hard. Like, you're paying for the exclusivity of it. From last year, and it was not really worth it. So, yeah, it's a miss. But at the same time, like, you never know. Just use your best judgment.
Yeah, and with that being said, like... A lot of times, these paid ones that go to charity. So, I mean, if you're interested in the companies that are throwing it and you want to get something to charity, and it's not like they cost you a lot of money. Like, I see ones go for like $28 around that range. That's not terrible for a party at nighttime. And they have food and drinks there you're paying for. Not the worst thing in the world. You pay for dinner and a show.
It's kind of like a concert ticket, you know? And if you've got the money to spend and you think it's something interesting, I mean, use your best judgment. But the main thing is, like, always be on the lookout for parties and always remember that, like, people announce this stuff, you know, anywhere from a month to, you know, a couple of days before the event. And it's, you know, it's always something that if you're looking for an extra thing to do while you're there, it's a really good option.
And then that being said, with the ones I call them, like, sticker parties, those are hard to get into.
If you follow things the right way, you'll get
lucky. Yeah, and you talk to people a certain way. Like, so, well, here's what, and I'll give props to Robert, because it was all him that one time. A few years back when, before Dishonored from Bethesda came out, they had a big booth there. We went there. That was one of our unicorns that year. Went there in the morning, played it. And I don't know, how did you get noticed on the whole party thing?
They actually announced it at it was in the blog. It was just like a really brief mention in the blog post about PAX. Oh, like, nice. Hey, we're going to be at PAX. Also, keep an eye out for these invitations. And yeah, there was basically just, it was one of those things where, like, we asked at the booth and they didn't know what we were talking about. I was just like, we haven't heard anything about it. Like, party invitations, we're just giving out these weird speakers.
Yeah.
And so we, like, hunted around and there was a guy standing out in front of the convention center, just really nondescript. And he was just, like, handing out these invitations, and it's like, oh, yeah, you guys want one? And he had a ton of them. Like, it wasn't really like this, like, hey, the first 50 people who find me get this thing. Like, he had a ton of them.
You got the room.
But, yeah, once, like, we grabbed him, it's like, oh, this is the thing. Like, this is, they didn't announce where it was going to be or anything like that. They were just like, he just showed up and was like, find me. And that ended up being probably the nicest party I think we've been to so far.
I agree with you.
Yeah, it was pretty intense, and it was, like... It was basically, like, themed around the game. Like, basically, if you remember, if anyone's played Dishonored, the mission that you have to find Lady something, the three ladies in the masks, they basically themed it around that entire thing. Yeah. And it was actually really intense.
And it was well done to where, like,
it was very well executed.
If you were to be at that party and then go play the game, all the costumes look on point. And, like, it was kind of creepy because the masks are kind of, like, eerie looking. And,
it was a little unnerving, but there were, like, guards, overseer guards at the doors and stuff like that.
Yeah, it was great. It was a good party. Time. Like, I said, it was the best ever. It was like being in the game. It's Tron the party.
Yeah. Yeah, it was
Tron,
pretty good.
By the way. That's our deal of parties. You don't have to go if you don't want to, obviously. But if you're looking for something cool to do that can maybe play a really cool memory of you and your friends or just by yourself, parties are a great way to do it.
Yep.
Robert, do you want to bring anything else up while you're here?
Just how bad I am at this game and why do we keep... This is the third time we've played this game on a stream and it's not really gotten any better. I don't know why you keep talking me into playing this game.
Wait, hold on. Wait, what's this? Your idea to play this game?
I don't know.
Yeah,
but I'm going to assume it was yours because I'm angry.
I have proof. I have empirical evidence that it was your idea. So.
I don't care about your evidence. When was the last time I cared about your evidence, Eric?
When was the last time I actually had evidence?
I don't have time for your facts is basically what the problem is here. And you keep thinking that I do.
So I think we're good today on the stream. Do you want to bring anything else up while we're here?
No, just that next week is definitely going to be definitely keep posting, because I think next week's going to be a good one. They should be posting the panel schedules this week. And imagine with the panel schedules posted this week, which we will definitely bounce that. We'll signal boost that on the Twitter a little bit so people can kind of know if you're following it. But I think with that coming up, we're going to see a lot more announcements, especially with Gamescom out of the way. A lot of times it's a little bit after Gamescom wraps up that a lot of people start to announce, like, whether or not they're going to be there, what they're going to have. I know we have a few confirmed vendors that I've talked to myself or have confirmed it on Twitter. Some of my favorites being Undead Labs, who are here in Seattle, which if you've played State of Decay or been in the beta for Moonrise, they are really cool people, and definitely go check them out. I know Motiga, who have Gigantic on deck. They just started their open beta, their closed beta, I think, which is super fun.
Yeah.
I've played that one a little bit at previous shows, and that's definitely one that I'm stopping by to say hi to those guys.
Yeah, oh, actually, let's close it off the stream with what we want our unicorn to be. And again, what we call our unicorn is the game that you know is going to be there, and you have to go play it.
Even if you don't have proof, because we have a lot of games that we're not convinced are going to be there, because I already know what yours is. And I'm still not. I don't have incontrovertible proof that it is going to be there. So I'm waiting to see. And yeah. You're convinced.
Well, I think the reason why you don't want to be there is to see me and your fiance cry.
That's what you want. I mean, I really don't. Your happiness is definitely something that I want to crush beneath my iron boot. But also, I keep telling you, I don't mind that you like this game. I'm sorry, I don't like it myself.
Anyway, so. Yeah, so yeah, Unicorn's a game you want to see there, you want to play, interact with, and you have to go see. That's what a unicorn is, at least to us. Here's my unicorn this year. Fallout 4. Oh, big surprise! Fallout 4. Slash? Doom 4.
You can't slash it. No, I know you can't.
I can slash where I want. I can slash everywhere. I can put basically a slash on the screen right now that we want to.
I'm not editing that in, so you just kill that pipe dream.
Oh no. This just in, Robert's not playing ball with people. We just take this ball and go home with it.
My ball is, I have a special pocket to put my ball in whenever I'm ready to go home.
Exactly. But anyway, you can't even put one picture slash the screen.
Probably, but I probably won't, because I'll lose track and forget.
Slash from the Turtles on there.
Don't make promises that I then have to edit in, is basically what the issue is.
Putting a picture of the video is really hard nowadays, folks.
You don't know how to do it.
Yeah, I can figure it out, though. If Ross can figure it out, I can figure it out.
Oh, shots fired. Calm down, man. To be fair, regardless of what he might tell you, I don't hate Fallout. I just don't. It's not one of my, like, big games. It's a hyped game, which not to say it's a bad game. It's just it's one of those very popular games that I never really got into. So he and my fiance are super excited for this game, and I'm just like, yeah, okay, whatever. Enjoy, have fun with your game. I'm glad that you were excited for something, but he's convinced that I hate it. Anyway,
so that's my discussion. I want to play Fallout 4 and also Doom 4. I have to play it. Also, at QuakeCon, they had a huge life-size Revenant. Do you know what a Revenant was from Doom 2?
No.
Basically, the Revenant was like, and it's a terrifying like monster. I love like,
well, it's, yeah, it anything kinda, with the word Revenant in it is yeah, a pretty good bet.
Yeah, like basically, like those kind of those monsters you love to hate to fight against because they're cool as shit, they're scary as hell, and they're hard to beat. Basically, it's like giant, it's like skeleton, it was weird like a breastplate armor with like rockets on each shoulder that would just like either shoot rockets at you or come in and punch you in the face and just kill your ass.
Yeah.
Super terrifying.
Face punching is a pretty deadly maneuver.
Exactly. But like they have a giant Revenant statue and I hope to God. And they said cool, they had like, props of like shotguns and like chainsaws there. Yeah. Take photos with. I hope they bring it to PAX. They should. I mean, why wouldn't they? It's a giant statue they made, you know?
Yep.
Had
to get one more death in, folks.
So, yeah, playing Doom 4 is a big deal. I'm a big Doom kid growing up. My dad and I love Doom. I still love Doom. I'm going to buy the Doom shirt this year.
It's happening.
The box art t-shirt.
Oh,
I love that shirt. It's such a good shirt. I'm going to buy it this year. Every year, I'm like, yeah, it's cool. I'm going to buy it. Yeah. I'm like, why not? It's $20. Buy it, you know?
Yeah, well, yeah. If you're buying stuff.
Yeah. So bring money, kids. Anyway, so what are your unicorns, Robert?
You know what's weird? I don't know that I have any major unicorns. This is not like me, like, I don't have an answer, so screw it. Like, I've been thinking about it, and there are a ton of games that I want to play if they're there, but nothing that I haven't played a little bit of already, or, it's just like, I have to get in line for this, and it's going to, like, now I know, like, the two that I'm really excited to play if they're there, which I'm not sure about it because it's a bit contentious and it's coming out pretty soon is Metal Gear Solid 5. I haven't actually gotten my hands on with that game.
They still have a demo there.
Yeah, well, but it's coming out just a week or so after the.
Yeah, but I guess you're doing it like a giveaway, so
it is entirely possible too. Kojima was actually there last year, which of course Kojima isn't associated with the game anymore, so nothing there. That's another thing is like with Konami being the way they are right now, I don't know that that's going to happen, but we'll have to wait and see. But I do want to get my hands on the game. Another one is actually, and this is a recent one, Ubisoft's For Honor, which I mentioned to you. I don't know if you got a chance to watch the video.
I haven't checked it out
yet. It looks really interesting, and I really want to get it. It's like pre-alpha right now. But I really want to get my hands on it and try it out. And what I'm hoping is that it's one of those games, it's not going to take up as much of Ubisoft's focus. It's like, you know, they're going to have like a giant Assassin's Creed Syndicate banner, and they're going to have, you know, Rainbow Six Siege stuff out there, which I'm really not as excited for those games as I have been in the past. So they're not going to be on the top of my list. But if there's a demo station for For Honor, I will be in that line. I'm definitely going to play... I'm gonna get in line for Gigantic, which is it's one of those I'm not overly excited because I've played it already, but it's super fun. If you haven't played it yet, you should be excited about it because it's, especially if you're kind of missing the competitive Team Fortress scene, but are super tired of MOBAs, check out Gigantic because it is worth your time. As of right now, I think those are my major. Those are the major games I want to get in line for. That might change when I see the listing, so I may have to delay my answer to a later stream.
What about No Man's Sky?
Yes, that is actually. Thank you very much. Because if it is there, which I don't know if they've been demoing that game yet. Because I try to watch for Gamescom to get an early feel of like what potentially could be at PAX.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're gonna demo that, but if they do, I will. Yeah, that one actually might end up being my first day. That game looks fascinating.
Okay, well, I think we're done today for the stream. Thank you, everybody, for watching. I hope you really enjoyed it, and I hope you improve your PAX experience all together. Robert, any last words?
Once again, if anyone has any questions, we're going to be doing a lot more question and answer kind of stuff, pulling some questions from different sources over the next couple of weeks to kind of round out everything. But if you have any questions that you would like for us to look into or answer, please tweet them to us. Please let us know. We are always listening. Other than that, we will see you sometime next week.